the topic here. What I'm going to be doing today is to discuss not just the neurobiology of OCD, to discuss the role of neurobiology of OCD in a comprehensive fashion might be difficult to do in a span of 40-45 minutes, or rather, it might be useful to have some snippets of neurobiology of OCD. We'll glance through important aspects of it, and we'll try and see if certain aspects of our understanding regarding neurobiology can be linked to the treatment-related parameters. So this is going to be the outline of what we'll discuss today. We'll start with some snapshots on what is meant by etiology of OCD and what is meant by pathophysiology of OCD. Specific focus on cognitive deficits, which are really important in terms of understanding of OCD's neurobiology. Some circuitry models of OCD and what does it do into, or how does it contribute to the understanding of compulsivity. Is there a role for anxiety in OCD? Because many people still believe that OCD is an anxiety disorder, and probably there is no reason to keep it aside and keep it separate in a different chapter altogether. And if so, the circuitry, how does the circuitry translate into our understanding of how cortex controls the subcortex? And finally, on neuromodulation, can we take this understanding of the circuitry model of OCD into applying some of the novel treatment strategies? So this is what I'm going to be doing in the next, say, around 40 minutes or so. So we'll start off discussing what are the key features of OCD. We know that OCD has certain salient features of repetitiveness of thoughts or whatever element of consciousness it is. It comes with either images or urges. Compulsions are generally repetitive actions or thought or cognitive processes which help in reduction of anxiety, which comes with obsession. So it always has a purpose of reducing anxiety. And symptoms are quite distressing, time consuming and impairing in many patients. Some of the features that are relevant for our understanding of the biology also would be the content of OCD, because it is increasingly becoming clear that OCD is not a unitary disorder. Probably it has difference in the phenomenology as well as in the neurobiology based upon the symptom dimensions that the patient presents with. So it's important for us to understand the biology of washers differently from the biology of checkers or people who have so-called forbidden thoughts like sexual obsessions or blasphemous obsessions and so on. There are different affects that people describe. Some people describe distress, some people describe disgust, whereas some people might not discuss anything. They might say that I'm doing it simply because I just have to do it. And you call, nowadays there is a special categorization for that. There's a phenomenon which is described called, can someone say what is that phenomenon? It's a sensory phenomenon which is described in OCD. It's getting recognition now in ICD-11. It might have a place. Now, ranges of insight that you see in OCD, typically OCD is defined as something which has a really good insight to contrast it from the psychotic illnesses, while we know that around 20% of people have poor insight into their symptoms, and the comorbid conditions. And when you talk about comorbidities, the most common one is anxiety as well as depression. Of course, the other concerns like OC spectrum conditions like BDD, etc. also has a role. Now, these comorbid conditions also have a significant role in terms of how do we understand the biology, because we understand biology based upon the studies that are conducted. We need to understand if these people who are studied have concomitant comorbid conditions also, because of the exclusion of comorbidities, do we still find out a way by which we can delineate biology. So there are two aspects to it. One is etiology and pathophysiology. Can somebody describe what is the difference between this? How does it matter? Because etiology versus pathophysiology, it's a very interchangeable term. People keep using it in a different way. Etiology generally talks about how we are mentioning a causative factor to it, because here we're talking about OCD to be due to certain genes, to be due to metabolic causes, or if it is because of infectious agents, especially in childhood. There's a description of autoimmune entity called PANDAS. Now it is renamed into PANS, because the etiological causative role of streptococcus has not been really proven. And of course, that can happen because of various other reasons. Once in a while, you do see patients who come referred from neurology or various other departments having, OC symptoms, after the occurrence of a certain insult to certain parts of the brain. But when you talk about pathophysiology, it's important for us to understand that we're not talking about the cause, rather we're talking about the mechanisms. Because there has been a lot of research on the cause of OCD, but then nothing really has been a consistent finding. But what we know is that there are certain possible mechanisms which play a role in causing some of the outcomes such as the cognitive deficits or the symptoms that happen. So you have brain circuitry-based abnormalities which are demonstrated, and these are the abnormalities that are seen in cortico-striato-thalamo-cortical circuits, which are in abbreviation we call it CSTC, and sometimes people simply call it frontal-striatal circuitry, but then to be specific for OCD, you make it CSTC. And there are specific brain-based deficits that are important. One is the response inhibition-related deficits, which are a highlight of OCD. And fear extinction, it plays a significant role in terms of your treatment with CBT or exposure response prevention, for instance. So we are going to discuss about pathophysiological aspects when I talk about neurobiology, not so much about the etiological aspects. Okay, so in a nutshell, you know that for any disorder, for that reason, you have various theories that are proposed, which start from the vulnerability-related factors such as genetics. Then you have the neuroimmune factors, which are thought to happen during early development. Then it translates into neurotransmitter abnormalities, which is immediately translated into your into the clinics. The way we use our medications like SSRIs or antipsychotics as augmenting strategies and so on. Probably much more superficial to our understanding could be the neurocognitive deficits, which are invariably seen in OCD. It's a highly replicated finding in OCD. And then finally, there is a possibility that neurocognitive deficits might form a template for the symptoms which are overtly seen. So the understanding currently is that there is a possibility that neurocognitive deficits, the cognitive dysfunction, might form the basis of the symptoms of OCD. So with this idea, probably we might be able to trace it back and understand what could be the basis of symptoms. So the cognitive deficits for OCD are tested using certain neuropsych functions. So you have certain rules that keep changing when you are applying this particular task. It comes with a particular rule. It could be, a person has to adapt to a particular shape. Initially, it might change to the rule of color. It might change to the rule of number. So, one has to have a flexible brain in order to know this task properly. What has been seen is that people with OCD tend to have a deficit in this cognitive flexibility. And this cognitive inflexibility might be the reason as to why they are so stubborn in doing certain compulsions that they end up doing. I mean, it's a very, very simplistic way of putting it across. There is another task, which is the Stroop task. Anything else? Attention, of course. It's a very basic function, right? So what is next to that? It's an executive function, of course. It generally tests error monitoring. How easy is it for you to monitor for the errors and do you make mistakes when you are given a situation which is rapidly changing and something which is conflicting to your mind. So it probably resolves a conflict in your brain as well as keeps a track on errors. So generally in people with OCD, it is said that people have a greater error monitoring abnormality, which is attributable to certain midline cortical structures like cingulate cortex. And then the last one is a complex figure test, RCFT. So this complex figure test generally is a function of visual memory as well as visual organizational abilities. So visual organizational abilities is another important finding which has been replicated as a concern which is in comparison to healthy volunteers. So these are the tasks which are relevant to OCD. So I'm giving in one slide, if I were to summarize which are the very important and the most replicated cognitive deficits seen in OCD, I would say the ones which are mentioned in yellow are the ones which you might have to keep in your mind. The ones such as overactive, error monitoring, response inhibition, and motor output suppression. Then your set shifting abnormality or cognitive inflexibility testing. Decision making ability, which is a higher cortical function, because it might be a culmination of multiple things starting from attention to different concerns such as response inhibition. But ultimately, decision making has been found to be abnormal in OCD in many studies. And non-verbal memory, if somebody were to ask you, is memory affected in OCD? It is not the episodic memory or the verbal memory which is generally seen as abnormal, It is the non-verbal memory, which is tested using the RCFT kind of paradigms. So I went through a couple of meta-analyses to see whether all these functions are uniformly affected across various studies. If you were to look at effect sizes of which cognitive deficit is greater, I mean, has a greater impairment, when you look at it, you can see that effect sizes are for non-verbal memory, it seems to be really high. For response inhibition and set shifting also, it seems to be quite high. I mean, the effect size of 0.5 is considered to be a good effect size, something that separates from a, something that really stands out. So we need to remember that these three cognitive deficits can be important. Of these, probably the ones we need to look at whether some of these things can be linked to some of the symptoms. So some of the candidates that, I mean, I'm going to talk about some of the studies that we have done in our lab in order to, see whether, test out whether these things are really true or not. This is something which was done by one of our PhD students. So Emma examined this question using EEG. So what was done is that people with OCD who did not have any comorbid conditions and people who were medication naive, which means that their brains are not affected by the status of the medicines that they're taking. It's really important because we need to study the brain, a brain which is not confounded by the effects of medications. So she tried examining whether error-related negativity, which is a paradigm, which tests error monitoring and response inhibition, mostly error monitoring. This paradigm works on a principle that the moment you make an error, the brain gives a signal, whether you are consciously doing it or not, but there is an electrophysiological signal that is detectable in EEG. It's almost like an oops moment. I made an error, and that there's a deflection that is seen. It's a negative wave, and that's called error-related negativity. And what was seen is that there's an enhanced amplitude of error-related negativity in patients in comparison to healthy volunteers. There are other ways to test this concern. So you have other tasks like the oculomotor tasks. For example, your eye movements also, when you're trying to do certain things consciously, you're using some of these cognitive functions. So it might not be dependent on a person's educational status. For instance, there's something called anti-saccade task. Some of you might be aware of this. Anti-saccade is essentially when you have a particular target which comes on one part of the screen. The instruction is to not look at that particular part, rather look at the mirror image location of that particular object on the screen. So if it comes from the right at a particular angle, you're supposed to, consciously make an effort to look at the opposite side of the screen. So this is what happens. You see the red dot which moved towards the left side, and there was a target bigger dot which moved towards the right side. This is a healthy person doing it. It's a sample which I've taken from the eye tracking. So what if, as you can see here, there's the green dot first moved towards the red and then went back. So it's almost as if the person suddenly makes an error, is not able to inhibit the response of looking towards the other side. So this is an anti-saccade task, and that's an error which was committed during anti-saccade tasks. And what was found is that anti-saccade error percentage was significantly greater in OCD patients in comparison to healthy controls. Again, to highlight the fact that anti-saccades might represent the response inhibitory function of the brain, and this seems to be abnormal in OCD patients. So how do we understand OCD? Is it purely understood from the point of view of whether it is a compulsive disorder, or do you want to understand it from the point of view of an anxiety disorder? There are various theories which support either of these things. When you talk about compulsivity, it probably has the greatest evidence base, because it is understood as either a compulsive disorder or element of impulsivity associated with it. That's a significantly impaired response inhibition which is seen in OCD. And this probably is due to a cognitive top-down regulation of subcortical structure. This has been one assumption which is being studied. On the other hand, there are studies which also talk about the fact that we know that very well that OCD has anxiety. There's an element of anxiety which is significantly present in OCD. And some of the symptoms of OCD, such as the harm avoidance or the doubts that happen in OCD or the uncertainty that people have, might be related to the anxiety element of OCD. And this probably is due to a hyper-responsive limbic circuit which is seen in OCD. And probably we make use of this particular understanding in treating OCD in terms of how CBT works. Probably exposure and response prevention works in the principle of habituation and extinction of the fear. Probably we can start with examining probably the base, most replicated and the basic concept. Yeah, the basic tenet is that you have cortical structures which pass through subcortical structure of basal ganglia in a very organized fashion, and finally it reaches the thalamus and it is relayed back into the cortex. So this is in nutshell. You have seen this diagram in pretty much in various conditions. You go to neurology, they talk about the same structure in Parkinson's disease, tic disorder, the same thing is spoken about. So ultimately, you have orbitofrontal cortex, which is a key structure which was described initially by Saxena's paper, and subsequently various structures got added to it. It passes through striatum and then relate back to thalamus through two different circuitries, which is direct and indirect circuitry. So in nutshell, direct disinhibits, indirect inhibits. That's a very simple way to remember that. Probably there's an imbalance between these two aspects. But to add to complexity, we know very well that it's not a very simplistic equation that we're talking about. There are various paradigms which are abnormal in OCD. One is how affective and reward processing also could be affected in OCD. You have executive dysfunction in OCD, such as the working memory and planning. And then you have the response inhibition and motor preparation related deficits. So you have three different circuits which has been finally discussed. One is the affective circuit, dorsal cognitive circuit, as well as the ventral circuit. All these circuits pass through certain topographically relevant areas within the basal ganglia or the striatum, and it's laid back into certain specific nuclei of thalamus, and it is taken back. Why should we know so much about which aspect of thalamus, which aspect of basal ganglia, etc.? Because now there are specific treatments such as surgeries which are focusing on certain specific regions. For example, if I were to talk about nucleus accumbens, the ventral part of the striatum, nucleus accumbens is one of the targets for deep brain stimulation. The place where electrode is kept for deep brain stimulation. So this is the understanding which is used in treating as well. So you have partially segregated circuits, but what has been seen is that there are certain aspects of the circuits which are overactive, and there are certain aspects of the circuit which are hypoactive. So when you look at the dorsolateral prefrontal cortical functions of OCD, we know very well that there is a working memory dysfunction, there is a planning dysfunction. When you're talking about dysfunction, we're actually talking about a deficit or dampening in the function of this particular region, which means that the dorsal circuit seems to be not working really well, while the ventral circuit, which is the error monitoring, the response inhibition, it actually, it's almost like that circuit seems to be overactive. So there is an overactive ventral, whereas there's a hypoactive dorsal. In other words, people have hypothesized that the reason why the ventral circuit is overactive might be because of the fact that dorsal circuit is not able to, you know, exert a control over the ventral circuit as well. So this is one possibility which is being discussed now, such as sensory motor circuit. Because, you know, when you ask your patients, for instance, some people, when you ask them why do you wash, they will tell you, I'm washing because I have to get rid of germs or contamination. There's a purpose, there's an action. Action comes with an outcome, right? So we all wash because we all do some activities because you talk about an outcome for that activity. But then there are certain situations wherein after a while, when the whole habit sets in, then you don't really think about the outcome. The moment I see a wash basin, I have to wash. Means it is, there's no purpose which is associated with that. So that is what happens to many of the patients after some time, when the chronicity of the illness sets in. So probably compulsivity, when it occurs across many years, probably there's a shift in something called action outcome related paradigm in our brain to something called stimulus response. Probably this particular aspect is something which is regulated by the supplementary and pre-supplementary motor areas. The reason why I'm highlighting this is because this area is pretty accessible. It's very close to the vertex, and it's almost very close, as in very quite superficial an area, very thin strip of gray matter which is available there. So people have started using this as a target for non-invasive brain stimulation. Could be either RTMS or things like TDCS and so on. Then you have the ventral reward circuitry, ventral cognitive, dorsal cognitive, and the frontolimbic circuitry. So this is a nutshell. In nutshell, this is the diagram which might help you remember the various circuit abnormalities in OCD. Now, is anxiety a concern in OCD? Answer is yes. Is it a cause or an effect? Nobody really knows. But then, do we really have to worry about anxiety? Yes, we do have to. But then probably the discussion regarding whether OCD has to be kept away from anxiety disorder chapter or not appears to be too artificial and boring.
But ultimately, we should remember that OCD definitely has anxiety, and in order to understand the biology, we need to know about anxiety as well. So the structures that are important in this regard is amygdala, probably the core structure which is involved in any anxiety disorders, for that reason be it phobias or PTSD, any concern. But having said that, it might not be a primary concern with amygdala, it could be a concern with the regulation of amygdala by a superior structure or a cortical structure named ventromedial prefrontal cortex. I will come to that. And before I come to that, how do we understand whether it's because of whether there's anxiety, anxiety is an important aspect of OCD or not? So the way in which it is understood is through certain paradigms which are administered under fMRI. That the way in which brain responds to your stimuli that you present. So in phobias, this is the way in which it was initially studied, was using, for example, spider phobia or fear of heights. So you expose them to pictures which threaten them or cause anxiety to people who suffer from these conditions, and then compare that with the responses that are seen with people who do not have this condition, healthy individuals. So you try and compare the responses in the blood flow to the brain, which is otherwise known as bold responses, right? Blood oxygen level dependent contrast. You compare and contrast, essentially it's a subtraction of two different contrasts which happen in the brain. You subtract the contrast which is associated with certain set of pictures minus neutral pictures. So how does it fare between two different conditions? That's what happens in fMRI. So instead of phobias, in fact it's almost a decade since people have started examining this question whether these paradigms can be used to understand OCD or not. So some of the pictures, like for example a very dirty wash basin, a fecal matter, or something which would be related to disgust, things which are related to symmetry, things like lock, for example, it might evoke the habit of checking in certain individuals. These are all combined into one particular paradigm which runs for a few minutes under the scanner, and people keep looking at it passively, or sometimes they even appraise it. They might be asked to give an answer. Does it provoke anxiety for you? Yes, no, etc., etc. So this particular method is called symptom provocation paradigm under fMRI. What has been shown in symptom provocation paradigms is that the anxiety which happen in symptom provocation is directly proportional to the responsiveness of amygdala in terms of the neurohemodynamic changes that happen in amygdala, the fMRI changes that are observed in the amygdala. Probably not just amygdala, it might be other regions as well. And this is one study which one of our senior residents, when he was doing his MD thesis, he completed this study in people who are washers and people who have never been medicated in their life. They came for the first time and they were examined using this paradigm. So he found abnormalities in multiple brain regions like anterior prefrontal, dorsolateral prefrontal. So finally, we were not able to really place our hands into one particular region, but then what is seen is that amygdala and limbic areas appear to be really important contributors to anxiety. And probably anxiety has a role to play in other cognitive functions as well. For example, a person with OCD makes mistakes only in certain situations and not in every situation. For example, a person checks, person has a doubt and a person keeps checking only in certain, for example, his doorknob or something else. But the person doesn't consistently do it across all the aspects of a person's life. Why is that due to? It probably is because there's a significant amount of emotional balance which is given to that particular stimulus, and hence the person makes a mistake into that. And how do we test that? And we test by combining emotional interference into response inhibition and error monitoring. There's one paradigm which was used to test out whether when you introduce certain emotional elements into the task, whether they make more mistakes in comparison to neutral situations. So this is one particular study which we recently completed. We found that there was a significant involvement of prefrontal cortical as well as insular. Insular is one region which is generally related to conferring a particular balance or an importance to a particular stimulus. You know, our brain decides whether this particular stimulus is important or not based upon insular's activity. Now, when you look at the neuroimaging findings, it's pretty vast. In fact, there are so many studies which talk about how different structures are either having increase in volume, reduction in volume, and so on. Even if when you go through the review articles, you find it quite mind-boggling, because you don't really finally come to a real conclusion, because it used to be very clear at some point of time, but recently as the number of imaging studies keep increasing, we find that the results are getting more and more muddled up and unclear. Because initially people spoke about orbitofrontal cortex, then striatum, then thalamus, etc. Probably that's because the samples were pretty small and they had very, very severe OCD to study. And also probably because there were a lot of other confounders. You know, people took out people having depression, people were on medications and so on. But now there are attempts to look at larger samples, excluding comorbid conditions and so on. We don't really get a very clear and beautiful, perfect picture like the way we would expect it to happen. So now there is there was a working group in which we also participated in terms of contributing the neuroimaging scans, and there's a pooled analysis of all the scans across, almost from various centers, almost 30 centers across the world. And there were many scans, in fact. The number of scans, as you can see, is 1,830 OCD patients compared to almost 1,800 healthy controls. Probably it's a really good sample. And what was seen in this particular study, in this particular analysis, initially we did a subcortical analysis of subcortical structures, and later on analysis of cortical structures. What was found is that people with OCD tend to have a greater pallidum, that is globus pallidus volume. So there is definitely a basal ganglia pathology which is seen in OCD, and not so much with various other structures which were studied. In addition, depression seems to be contributing to hippocampus volume. Hippocampus volume is lesser, but then the moment you include depression as a confounding variable, the effect goes off. So which means that hippocampus has an important role as far as the limbic structures is an important, understandable thing, that it is also probably involved in this. Then later on, there have been some studies which looked at, as you can see, there are various regions which are found to be abnormal. We examined the same question to find out whether in a large sample of unmedicated people, is there a difference between OCD patients versus healthy controls. To our surprise, the answer was that it was negative. Our OCD brains did not differ in a big way in comparison to healthy controlled brains, meaning to say that we might be dealing with significant functional changes in the brain, or probably, rather than structural changes that happen in the brain. And then same meta-analysis was done on the cortical brain structures. So the cortical thickness, cortical surface area, etc. were examined separately. What was found is that there was a decreased cortical thickness in bilateral inferior parietal cortex and left transverse temporal cortex. Doesn't make any sense. What we spoke so far has been about certain specific circuitry related aspects of the brain, whereas we are finding differences in the parietal lobe, finding in the temporal lobe and so on. So this it was a very difficult paper to discuss ultimately, but then finding is a finding from a very large sample. So what has been proposed is that there are other regions, not just confined to the corticostriatal circuitry, which might have abnormalities in terms of the structural changes, but the functional concerns probably might be related to these the frontostriatal regions which I previously mentioned. Then comes the question, is it primarily a cortical concern or is it a subcortical concern? And this has been one question which has been answered, which requires an answer by, because surgeons would want to believe that this is a subcortical concern, because deep brain stimulation is being increasingly done in subcortical regions, whereas there is a group of people who study RTMS for instance, or TDCS for example, the study is done in cortical regions. So is it really a cortical or a subcortical concern? To be fair, people might believe that it's a cortico-subcortical regulatory related concern. So in order to test that, people examined it using various paradigms. What they found is that during symptom provocation, and when you are asked to appraise a particular stimulus after each symptom provocation, the regions which were found to be abnormal are midline cortical structures like ventromedial prefrontal cortex, in addition to the limbic structures like amygdala. Okay. Now, is it compulsivity or is it anxiety or both? So how do you understand that? If you use a paradigm which is for compulsivity, you would probably substantiate your claim that it might be because of compulsivity. But how do you test whether OCD is because can you think about a neurobiological way to understand whether it's because of anxiety or not? There are paradigms for fear extinction. You give a conditional stimulus and an unconditional stimulus coupled on a particular day. For example, you show a particular face of a person, and then the person would have a wrist band which gives a very small electric shock, which is coupled with certain images and not with certain other images. And there is a learning that happens on the day one. On the day two, there is a reversal of that particular thing, but while a second day scan is acquired, the same responses that happen for the ones which used to deliver shocks on the first day would be replicated on the second day, despite no shocks being given for those pictures. It means that the brain is learning certain things, which is required. A healthy learning is required, but the brain is not able to reverse that learning. Once a fear is acquired, the brain is not able to take away or give away the kind of learning which happened on the day one. So this is called a fear extinction paradigm. So it means that there is definitely an anxiety element in OCD, and it can be measured as well using certain paradigms. Now there is an aim to understand, because of all these shortcomings, because there is no uniformity in terms of how people have understood OCD, maybe because of the cohort effect, our population might behave differently, the symptom dimensions might be different, so many factors. So now there is an attempt wherein different countries are now participating to contribute to understand using a common protocol to understand what is a neurobiological signature of OCD. Now, when you talk about neural circuitry, it is also important for us to understand whether this neural circuitry responds to your intervention. And how does the brain respond to your intervention? There has to be change which happens in a consistent fashion. For a change to happen in a consistent fashion, there has to be change in the concept of neuroplasticity. So will a neuroplasticity alter in OCD is one important question. So if there are possible hypotheses, we all know that across various psychiatric disorders, one important neurotransmitter which is considered as relevant for neuroplasticity is glutamate, because it's probably the most common excitatory neurotransmitter in the cortical regions. So this probably says that at the moment we know there is some evidence to say that there is elevated CSF glutamate in OCD in comparison to healthy controls. In vivo studies talk about possibility of increased glutamate signals which are understood through magnetic resonance spectroscopy, and there are some genetic association studies of certain glutamatergic genes which show a differential association in OCD in comparison to healthy volunteers. This was one of the initial studies by Dr. Sumant and Sarnik Bhattacharya when they examined CSF autoantibodies and elevated levels of glutamate in CSF. Subsequent MRS studies which spoke about in unmedicated pediatric OCD, there was one group which demonstrated glutamatergic abnormalities. And some of the recent studies from a couple of Nature papers which came in about how some of the animal models wherein there is a knockout animal model without a particular gene which is very closely linked to glutamate, this particular gene codes for certain anchoring proteins in the corticostriatal circuitry. The moment this animal had the knockout animals had a significantly greater grooming and certain behaviors which are repetitive in comparison to the other animals. And to examine this, one of our students examined whether there is a relationship between glutamatergic gene polymorphism and the brain, and there was a significant association between, imaging genetics association which was demonstrated in this particular study. Now, how do we translate this particular understanding from the neural circuitry into treatment of OCD? Probably that is more important for us, especially in a circumstance like this, which is not so infrequent. You see these sort of clinical scenario very frequently. You have somebody who comes with no response to at least 4 or 5 SSRIs. You don't really know what to start for that particular person. Augmentation with CBT over 40 sessions, including inpatient CBT. You try your level best, nothing really works out. Pharmacological augmentation strategies such as risperidone, aripiprazole, memantin, N-acetylcysteine, and ondansetron. The reason why I listed out all these medications is because these are the ones which have either level B, at least level B evidence for augmentation related evidence. So you have such a person, then what would you think about in your mind? Of course, you keep trying some other SSRI again. That's what all of us do, that because we go ask them amongst all these SSRIs which one did help, which one helped you slightly better, then you might go back to that. But ultimately, these are people who are not just treatment resistant, they're probably treatment refractory. Refractoriness is a word which is used when you have multiple treatment options which has been tried and then nothing really works. So in such people, is there a role for brain stimulation in the treatment? So maybe with the understanding that we discussed now, is it possible for us to discuss about RTMS? Does it make sense to discuss RTMS or some of the other neuromodulatory treatments like TDCS in OCD? RTMS, you know that there are two kinds broadly. You have high frequency RTMS, which is generally excitatory, and low frequency, which is inhibitory, even though there are contradictions to this particular theory. But in general, when you use high frequency, which is more than 8 hertz, right? So anything more than 8 hertz is considered to be excitatory, and anything 2 or 1 hertz, for example, is considered to be dampening. So the advantage is that RTMS provides a very focal stimulation. It's non-invasive, doesn't require anesthesia. Before I get into RTMS, one has to really know that ECT probably has no evidence. And there is, we are tempted to start ECTs for certain individuals where we don't really know what to do. But at least there was a recent review which has gone through all possible retrospective studies that has been published till date. And it has been almost concluded that ECT really doesn't have any role unless the person comes with a really bad depression or suicidal ideations, etc. So there might be some variables which might respond, but not the core compulsions of OCD. Now, the disadvantage of RTMS is that it's an expensive instrument. It might not be available in all settings, so it has got its own concerns. So you have these targets which are demonstrated to be somewhat useful. Out of these, some of the targets might be slightly better in comparison to the others. The first one, dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, has been examined multiple times. In fact, there were 3 or 4 reviews. If you go through RTMS-related evidence, you might become a bit confused. I got totally confused after reading 3 meta-analyses because all 3 meta-analyses had 3 different results, and each of them were published 1 year apart. And it was quite surprising, but then there was one meta-analysis which included all the Chinese studies because the initial two authors could not understand. I mean, Chinese studies are published in Chinese ultimately, so you can't make sense of what is written there. So probably that is probably the one important variable which resulted in the difference. But having said that, we know very well that DL-TFC stimulation, used in various studies, the number of studies wise when you look at it, the effect size has been pretty less and it has not been really helpful. But to say that DL-TFC might not be helpful at all might be an overstatement, because there are some situations wherein you might want to think about DL-TFC stimulation. But evidence-wise, pre-supplementary motor area probably stands out in terms of the effect. And then comes orbitofrontal cortex, and then now recently dorsomedial prefrontal cortex is also being studied. It's a very deep structure. It might not be accessible to your classical RTMS, so one has to use specific coils, like deep coil, to access this particular region. So the meta-analysis which I would like to quote is this one, which was published in Journal of Affective Disorders, and it actually says that PSMA has got the best response with the effect size that is discussed here. And you also know that very recently, about a couple of months back, RTMS has got FDA approval for OCD. So I think that's an important aspect that you'll have to keep in your mind. Now comes TDCS, experimental treatment. It sounds attractive. Wherever I speak about TDCS, people are generally enthused by it because of the fact that it's pretty simple. It works on a very simple principle of an anode and a cathode delivering a very fixed DC, direct current. Of a very small amplitude, but the thing is that one should remember at this point of time it's still at its preliminary stages and experimental. I'm saying this again and again because the questions that happen after when we speak about this to practitioners is that what is the cost of this equipment, can we keep in the clinic, is it really useful for OCD, etc. It might not be advisable in the beginning itself until it is proven to be useful. But it's a very cheap, portable, non-invasive device which doesn't come up with any adverse event. That has been really proven. Adverse events are extremely minimal with this particular device. So some of the initial observations that have noticed usefulness of TDCS in OCD, open label observations, including ours, wherein we reported a couple of cases wherein we found a couple of people who had treatment refractory OCD responding remarkably well with TDCS when it was applied on pre-supplementary motor area using anode. We had our hypothesis that pre-supplementary motor area, when it is activated, it seems to have a brake-like effect on an overactive striatum. It is something which has been proven in healthy individuals. So we use the same premise in OCD patients. We found that to be useful. And that prompted us to study this in a randomized controlled manner. It was just an initial observation in the beginning. And this was an MD thesis which was completed by one of our students. It was an excellent work, in fact. What was done in this particular study is that there was a randomized observation between true TDCS and a sham TDCS. Sham was completely indistinguishable from true because that also produces some sensations on the scalp. But the person who was receiving TDCS would not know. The person who is administering TDCS would not know because there are some codes which are fed into the equipment. And the person who was rating our student, he also did not know whether it was a true or sham. So we had a third or fourth person who was delivering the central codes. So rather it was a triple blind design which ensured blinding for the study. We had around 25 people to be precise who were randomized to receive true and sham. 12 received true and 13 received sham in the study. What we did is that we also gave an option that after 1 week of TDCS, the TDCS was given for 20 minutes followed by a three-hour break, another 20 minutes, anode stimulation. Cathode was kept on the right supraorbital area like a reference, just to complete the circuit. The thing is that after 5 days, we did the Vipox again, and if the Vipox score was, improvement was less than 25%, it means that the TDCS is not working. It's not working. If it is not working, we gave them an option. Since it is not working the first phase, they are given an open label extension option. They might opt into getting into an open label extension. So which means that initially if somebody has received sham, there's a possibility that they will shift over, they'll be crossed over to true TDCS in the next week. So this was a result of the study. We found that there was a significant difference between true and sham TDCS in this particular study. That out of 12 individuals who received sham, none of them had responded. And out of 12 who received true, 4 had responded, while 13 sham individuals, none of them responded. So there was a significant change in terms of Vipox reduction of at least 25 or 35%. There's an advancement of this technique called high definition TDCS, which allows us to make a very precise kind of a stimulation, wherein you have the MRI of that particular individual, you decide for that particular person where is the XYZ coordinate of the presupplementary motor area, and then you deliver TDCS. So this particular technique gives a stimulation very specifically. So we found there's an open label observation that we have at this point of time. It is still under submission. We don't have a published result yet. So it showed us, gave a significant result in terms of Vipox reduction for these individuals. But having said that, just by stimulating one particular area, not everybody responds, isn't it? There's a huge variability in response. It might be explained because of the kind of symptoms that person might be suffering. Presupplementary motor area stimulation might not cater to all the needs, all the kinds of targets that one would want to achieve. So this is one example wherein this one group from Amsterdam, they have examined this question of whether stimulation on dorsolateral prefrontal cortical area, can it work specifically affect the emotion regulation? We know that DRPFC is a region which probably has a significant role in controlling, in modulating the emotional responses. If so, the implication would be that people who have greater emotional regulation related deficits might choose this particular, you might choose this particular target for such individuals. For example, disgust prone individuals. I mean, that's an emotion which is really spiking in certain individuals, so you might want to use it. But these are all the implications of the study. This is an RTMS study which compared true RTMS versus sham. So what we are doing right now is we are looking at what this particular question in a much more biological fashion by looking at what happens to the brain connectivity when you give high definition TDCS, what happens to cortical glutamate in terms of understanding the neuroplasticity and so on. That again, we are doing it in a randomized manner. The important parameters of interest would be not every brain is, our brains are not always active. For example, OCD brain doesn't need to be always active, which means that when you give a stimulation, if the brain is active, it might have a greater relevance than giving stimulation to a very resting brain, which means that, for example, a person is viewing something which is totally difficult for them to view, something which is relevant to their OCD, they might have a greater response. It's called a state-dependent stimulation. Now, these are all newer paradigms which are getting tested, and stimulation depending upon the predominant symptom. For example, disgust, maybe DRPFC, and so on. Now, probably towards the end of it, we'll come to surgical interventions in OCD. I'll just give a brief overview of what are the brain regions which have evidence in terms of surgical interventions. You know broadly that there are two different kinds of surgical interventions. One is the ablative procedure and the other one is deep brain stimulation. So ablative procedures comes with a concern that, you know, you can't reverse it. Once you make a lesion, the lesion is there. And but it's less expensive, probably less cumbersome. It doesn't require a maintenance that way, like the way DBS has. Whereas DBS comes with the DBS is basically you have an electrode which is implanted into a certain brain region, and the wires run into a battery, and the battery has to be kept under the skin. It's a subdermal implantation that happens. It has to be calibrated once in every 6 months, like the way they do in Parkinson's disease, for example. Now, difficulty in OCD is that it's a behavioral disorder. You cannot monitor the changes like the way, for example, in Parkinson's. If you have a chance to, I mean, there are some centers which do it for Parkinson's in Mumbai. You know, Dr. Paresh Doshi does it very frequently here. So, thing is that when you do it in Parkinson's for tremors, intractable tremors, or for any movement disorder, you can actually see the change happening right on the table. The surgical table itself, whereas in OCD there's no way to do that. So we always have this difficulty of telling people that you will have to wait for at least 6 months, sometimes up to 1 year, the effect might gradually come in. So surgical interventions are not generally indicated until refractiveness is proven. There are a lot of people who come and talk to you, talk to us, you I'm sure in OPD sometimes it might happen that I've read about the surgery or I've read about DBS in the Google, so can you please suggest DBS? It is generally not a very liberal advice that we give. We always have to reserve it to people who are severely ill. But how do you decide that people are severely ill? There is a criteria which has been put forth. So indication is chronic, severe, disabling, treatment refractory illness. And there are some contraindications which are relative, unstable neurological illnesses, concomitant psychosis, bipolar, etc. So there has to be unremitting chronic OCD with a severity of which is cut off of more than 28 as. But this is not discretionary at the end of it for a clinician. Illness has to be really severe. It causes significant dysfunction. And there has to be evidence to say that there is refractiveness. How do you say that? There has to be at least a trial with at least two SSRI antidepressants each for at least 3 months. Clomipramine has to be tried unless clomipramine intolerability is clearly documented. CBT has to be done for so many sessions unless the person is absolutely not able to face the situations which cause anxiety and, you know, because of extremely difficult anxiety levels. Previous trials have not, but important thing is that you have to also go through the augmentation trials and various options that are available. And the person has to be informed consent after knowing that the response with this treatment would be approximately, how much? How would you convey the message across the room? 50%, 40 to 60% across studies, but then roughly when you say 50% chance, they might suddenly, you know, chance of grasp that word 50%, they might say, yeah, 50% chance is there, no, let me go through. But then 50% is, there is a 50% of chance that your WIPOC score would be reduced by 35%. You're not talking about 50% being absolutely all right and go, if you go from this hospital, absolutely fine. So that's the point. So when you tell all these things and put things in perspective, many people back out. That's a very common experience that we all have. When we sit and talk to them for some 20 minutes explaining what is this and the surgical consent, then generally people try to understand what this means. So it's important that you have a clear evaluation pre-surgically. Then generally there is an evaluation which is done not by the center where this procedure is done, it's by an independent committee. And in general, every city has its own committee and it's constituted by one psychiatrist, one neurologist, one neurosurgeon. And then finally one more psychiatrist who finally takes an opinion and conveys it across to the treating team. So these are two procedures in broader sense. So nowadays thermocoagulation is not commonly done. Gamma knife is a procedure used for ablative procedures. You have capsulotomy and anterior cingulotomy as the two most approved and most commonly used sort of ablative procedures. Other two, you might want to know the names of it, but then forget about it. These are the most common things. Then deep brain stimulation, nucleus accumbens, ventral capsule, ventral striatum, and subthalamic nucleus. I think these three are the most commonly used lesions. Now there is a good trial which came in NEJM, really influential trial which has come out on subthalamic nucleus, and now people are examining this particular region much better. So we, I mean, I'm just giving you some idea regarding what happened to some of the patients for whom we did surgery and we were able to follow. And just putting the Vibox course for three subjects now, there are three more subjects who have finished it, but then they're not really in a position to, it's almost not too long ago that I can give you a answer regarding that. But these people have at least completed 3 years post-surgery. So there were no immediate adverse effects for any of these three people. And they all underwent capsulotomy using gamma knife procedure. And subject number three had a generalized tonic-clonic seizure post-surgery, but then the person was on clomipramine, so we really don't know whether it's because of a drug-induced seizure or not. Unlikely to be because of the procedure itself. And there were no deficits on repeat neuropsychological testing in any of these subjects. One person is doing remarkably well, I can say that. But other two people, plus minus. One person definitely not doing well, the other person somewhere in the middle. One person is doing really well. But out of the three people who finished in the last couple of years, I would say one more person has been doing well. So it just tells us that there is around a 40% chance of somebody doing well with this procedure. So this is the outcome of surgery when it is compile it. 40 to 60% of people improve 6 to 24 months after surgery. So there is no immediate response that you see with any of the surgical procedures. The long-term acute adverse effects are listed here. Generally the ones which are discussed in detail are the cognitive deficits which might be accompanied, which is precisely the reason why you will have to get a neuropsychological assessment in a detailed manner prior to the procedure in order to see whether it is treatment emergent or we don't know whether it's pre-existing, because OCD by itself can have cognitive deficits, so it's important that you document. Deep brain stimulation, it's essentially it has three stages of how it is done. There's an image-guided insertion of electrodes, there's subdermal implantation of neurostimulator, programming of electrical parameters. Essentially you have to do it in a, the calibration has to be done in a periodic fashion. Mechanisms are not completely understood. It's supposed to cause a functional disruption in the circuitry of OCD. And these are the targets. I think the ones which are highlighted in black are the ones which you might have to remember: ventral capsule and striatum, nucleus accumbens, and subthalamic nucleus. This forest plot is from a plausible paper which looks at a meta-analytic finding of whether this is useful or not. It seems to be useful, as you can see that the effect size is 0.6. It is that's a place where there's an averaged effect size that is being noted there. So again, it almost coincides with the wisdom that around 40 to 60% of individuals might respond to it. Okay, fine. I think the rest of it regarding the DBS, I think we might, I don't think so much of detail is required. But what I would like to summarize at the end of it is that the neural circuitry models of OCD can generate potential treatment strategies, because not in many disorders in psychiatry that we talk so much about neurobiology in a focused manner, like the way we speak about an OCD. Probably in schizophrenia we talk about a much more widespread concern. We really don't know, it's quite elusive. But OCD, we believe that at this point of time that there is some circuitry abnormality which is being tested repeatedly now. Now, chronicity of compulsions might have a role to play, meaning to say that when you find somebody having an early stage OCD, it's prudent to treat them aggressively and then, you know, get the symptoms under control, because chronicity of compulsion sometimes can produce neuroplastic changes which can be difficult to reverse. And there is a potential utility of neuromodulation to target specific symptom domains. There's a possibility that might come up over time. Like for example, disgust can be one emotion which generally we don't talk so much about. We always use the word anxiety for everything, but if we are able to identify certain symptom dimensions of OCD separately and link it up with the neurobiology, we might be able to think of a solution. Now there is a role of neuromodulation to aid faster fear extinction. I didn't talk about it during the presentation. There have been some studies using RTMS, like the way, I mean, how many of you are familiar with this molecule called D-cycloserine? This is something which had a lot of hype at some point of time very recently. It's a molecule which is used for one of the isomers used for tuberculosis treatment, no? Second line treatment for tuberculosis. You know, it's got a very specific impact on how glutamatergic neurotransmission happens in some of the limbic structures, which was probably the reason as to why it was tested using some of the open label studies. Initially, one or two studies had a lot of use. I mean, they highlighted some of the use in people who are undergoing therapy. So when you're doing therapy, learning happens. And the fear-related learning happens because of a amygdala-related or limbic system-related learning. So what they say is that when you co-administer cycloserine, pre-administer cycloserine prior to sessions, the learning process was found to be faster. So that was one premise which was tested a few, in at least two or three studies initially. It really was not very successful. We have tried using it for some people, many people in fact, when we were admitted in the ward. We didn't find it really useful at the, in that sense. But then you don't really get the D isomer of cycloserine very frequently, so it's not available. So you resort to cycloserine generally. But in any case, what is important to note is that there is a possibility to enhance the learning that happens during CBT using some method. There's a potential method that can be examined. One such method that has been examined is RTMS. So RTMS concomitantly given with CBT versus CBT alone, or RTMS given as sham, active versus sham in two different arms, has demonstrated some effect of RTMS, concomitant RTMS, on faster learning and quicker number of sessions in CBT. Probably neuromodulation might have a role in that regard. And of course, the understanding of neurobiology is essential for our advancement of psychosurgery related options. So with this I conclude. I didn't go into the details of the drugs which are used in OCD, because I'm sure many of you would pretty easy to read up about the drugs related to OCD. SSRIs and augmenting strategies. So I'd like to thank some of the grant agencies as well as some of the neuromodulation programs which we are running, and people who are working in these neuromodulation programs, and a couple of grants, larger grants in which we are part of. And of course our larger team and Dr. Reddy, who has been leading us in this particular aspect. And I would suggest that you can go through the articles which we have published. One supplement, we edited, best edited one supplement in Indian Journal of Psychiatry, and that has been published last month in January. It contains 17 review articles. It's been written by experts, international experts in each field. For example, nosology has been written by Dan Stein. So what this is basically from the OCD symposium that we conducted a couple of years back. So whoever were the speakers, they were requested to give a review article, and they were kind enough to do that. So this is freely accessible. Like, you can download the PDFs of all these articles that I've already done.